It's not the story of others, it's the story of humanity. That's something that's so important to me as a history teacher. You see, when I was growing up, I was presented a very Eurocentric view of history. Though I loved history class, I never felt like I was a part of the historical narrative. And when my people were in the narrative, they were always the weak or the oppressed. But our students don't have to feel that way. They do not have to feel like the outsiders in history class. So today, I'm going to share with you a lesson I call my mystery vessel lesson that I do with my 10th graders in Long Beach, California. So let me start off by sharing these three vessels from my life. These are all vessels or containers. I remind students that a vessel is a container that can be used to store all sorts of things. In this case, these vessels store my hopes, my celebrations, my sorrows. And they're mysteries because these artifacts tell the story of me, but the kids don't know what is the story of Miss Saeed. So that's why I call them my mystery vessels. I also tell them that each one of these vessels represents a pivotal moment, or as we call it in big history, a threshold in my life. There are moments in my life that have shaped me to be the person that I am today. So they're arranged chronologically, and I want the students to figure out the story of Miss Saeed. Before we move forward, let's talk about how the kids are going to be doing this. Well, they're going to use their claim testers that we use in big history. They're going to make claims about my life and then test them using authority, which is expert opinion, logic, intuition, what does your gut tell you, and evidence. And when that evidence can be corroborated from multiple sources, their claims can gain greater validity. Now let's go ahead and contextualize where this lesson falls when I'm teaching history. Around this time of the year, we are studying artifacts from ancient humans. And these objects are really dull and mundane and boring for the students. Here, let's look at some samples of artifacts. We have a squash seed. We have a pottery that contains a depiction of fishing culture. And you see old tools. These objects don't contain relevancy to a 10th grader. And yet if they could only realize that applying their big history claim testers will help them unpack a rich history behind each one of these objects. So my mystery vessel lesson is an attempt to overcome that hurdle to help students approach foreign or unfamiliar objects with greater curiosity while applying their historical thinking skills. Let's go back to my mystery vessels. I remind the students of their big history claim testers and tell them to talk to their group, to make claims, and to figure out the story of Miss Saeed. And I let them loose. Their conversations are fantastic. As I'm walking around the room, I hear some kids use logic. They say, well, this very first vessel must represent Miss Saeed's origin story because she said they're placed chronologically. And I have evidence from class. She said that her family is originally from Pakistan, so this must represent her cultural heritage. Then they get to the peanut. They look at the peanut and they use authority. They say Miss Saeed is an expert on her daughter's health, and she told us that her daughter is allergic to peanuts. But my intuition tells me that it would be strange to have a peanut decoration in your home to represent your child's allergies. When they get to the last one, they get a little confused. You see, their logic tells them that this old vessel must represent an older time period in Miss Saeed's life. And yet, she put it as her most recent threshold moment. So something doesn't seem quite right here. After they finish their conversations, we regroup and we talk about what claims they made and how they tested them. We also discuss how, as historians, their job is to use their historical thinking skills to get to the closest approximation to the original story. We'll never know what exactly happened in that moment, but we can do our best to try to get as close as we can to the original story. By this point in class, I have them at the edge of their seats and they're dying to know what is the story of Miss Saeed and which claims that they made are actually true. So let's take a look. This first vessel does indeed represent my origin story. This box belonged to my paternal grandmother. My dad's mom died when my dad was very young, so I don't have that much information about my past. And so while this box is a mystery to the students, it's also a mystery to me. And perhaps in the future, we might uncover more information about my family's past, and it won't be as mysterious to me. For example, a few years ago, one of my dad's brothers shared my grandmother's old diary, and we learned a little bit more about the events in her life. This second vessel, the peanut, represents my family's coming to America in the 1970s. When Jimmy Carter was elected president, my mom and her sister became very excited because they lived in Georgia and they were happy that someone from their own home state had won the election. So they bought this peanut because Jimmy Carter had a peanut farm. Well, I was born in Georgia and I spent the first 5 years of my life in Georgia. So this peanut represents the very elements that make up who I am. During my first 5 years of life in Georgia, I spent time with my nuclear family and my extended family. Relatives would come and visit from all around the world, and I learned about my cultural heritage, but I also learned about what it meant to be an American. All those different values came together to make me who I am today. This final vessel was a centerpiece at a fundraiser for a nonprofit that I volunteer for that opens up schools in remote areas of Pakistan. This vessel represents me today. It represents my passion for education, my desire to help the underserved. And it represents so much more than that. You see, we purchased this vessel here locally in California, and then all the vessels at the fundraiser were painted with traditional Pakistani designs. So this vessel represents the eastern side of me as well as the western side of me. And you'll notice in the back, there's a chip and there's even a crack from the time my son dropped this vessel when he was a little child. And that's what this vessel represents today. Despite its flaws, its imperfections, it still stands sturdy and holds my bangles in my room today. And it's something that I will carry with me into the future. Now, the kids would have never guessed this complete story, but they did make some claims along the way that end up being a little bit true, and that gets them excited. It also gets them thinking about their own lives. What artifacts could they share? Let's take a look at this map. Look at all the countries represented in just my classroom this past year. What makes the journey of teaching so exciting is that this map changes every year. And every year is a new adventure into uncovering what stories my students hold. After this lesson, I have the kids take photographs of their own artifacts and share them with class. Here are some of the artifacts they shared with me just this past year. First, you see a baseball trophy. My student's grandfather came to America after the Cuban Revolution, and this trophy represents his assimilation into American culture and represents how his grandfather learned English. This next one is a sunka. It looks a lot like the mancala that I play with my own children today, except my student plays this game with her Filipino grandmother. Now you see an ushanka. This is a hat that belongs to the Red Army in the former Soviet Republic. My student has this hat to remind him of the struggles his own parents went through when they were living in the former Soviet Union. In fact, he even wore this hat at the last winter concert at my school while he played a solo on the piano. Next, you see an Armenian sailor's hat that my student's grandfather wore when he came to America. And he passed on the tradition of sailing to not just his children, but also to his grandchildren. Here, you see a Jamaican maroon statue that represents the plight of the enslaved people. And finally, I was surprised that one of my students carries around this box that contains sewing supplies. You see, he was worried that the art of Mexican handicraft would die with his generation, so he preserves that craft through his hands. So, where do we go from here? These kids have shared such amazing stories. Well, as they're talking, they start realizing something really amazing. As unique and beautiful as their individual stories are, they have a common thread. And in this case, I shared artifacts that show how different families came to America to escape injustices happening in their homelands. The students begin realizing that their parents suffered injustices in their countries, and those injustices may have been similar in some ways. It sparks such a deeper conversation than just reading about other people's struggles in a history book. From here, I can springboard into all sorts of history lessons. For example, later in the year, we do lessons on rights and revolutions, starting from the American Revolution all the way up to the current day. We discuss all sorts of different revolutions and what people were fighting for, and what do human rights look like. And if I know the stories of my students, I can weave their stories into my narrative. We don't just have to focus on the French Revolution or the Americas and focus on just those. We can actually weave in all sorts of revolutions. For example, Long Beach has a huge Cambodian population, and there's always students who want to share what their family went through under the Khmer Rouge and their family's immigration to the United States. Last year, I had a student whose family suffered through the revolution in Yugoslavia. He had a Bosnian family, and he talked about how his family came to America. It was a very heart-wrenching story that he shared. But suddenly, revolutions didn't seem so foreign. Now that they understood the plight of humans and the history of humanity, they were able to build better bridges to the standards that I already had to teach. And it made my regular history lesson so much more powerful. And isn't that what we're trying to do in our history class? To help students understand the power of the historical narrative? If we're thoughtful with how we use these narratives in our classroom, and we can build a culturally responsive classroom, we can really help our students see where their histories fit into the wider context. Our classrooms are filled with such rich artifacts, primary sources, and secondary sources. As history teachers, we can harness that information to create powerful lessons that help students understand their place in history and help them feel empowered to shape the future.